And that is 60 in 5.5 seconds for a slight uphill and for the slick roads that we're on.
Hey crew, I've got the key to that 23 Jeep Grand Wagoneer L. We are going to take it for a drive, but first let's check it out. It looks on the inside and outside. This is the Obsidian trim, so all the exterior details are blacked out, including that 7-slot grille, the surrounds for the LED projector headlights, DRLs, and turn signals, the fog lights down low, and the front air dams. The two tow hooks are also in black. This one is painted in bright white clear coat as a contrast to all the gloss black. The wheels are dark tinted 22 inches, wrapped in Goodyear Eagle Touring all-season tires, 285 section front and rear. The lower sills are gloss black. The Grand Wagoneer lettering and American flag are in black. The door mirror caps, window trim, and roof rails are as well. Stepping back to look at the profile, it's going to take a little longer with the L. We've got a 7-inch longer wheelbase, and it's a foot longer overall than the standard Grand Wagoneer. Right now, the air suspension is in the access height, so it's lowered, and the profile is a little funky. It's a mix, definitely, between an SUV and a wagon. At the back are LED taillights with turn signals. Grand Wagoneer, once again, in gloss black, and the lower bumper is blacked out as well with two hidden exhaust ports. I do like the Obsidian trim's black details. I just think that the profile isn't as handsome as vehicles like the Cadillac Escalade. What do you think? Is it better or worse looking than that or the Lincoln Navigator? Let me know in the comments and let's check out the interior. Opening up, power running boards deploy, and looking inside at this global black Palmero leather interior. The seats are supple, they're perforations, heating and ventilation in the second row. On the doors, we find sunshades. There's leather all over the door panel, including down here. You get a Macintosh 23 speaker sound system, textured aluminum trim, padding for your armrest, and one-touch up-down windows. To get into the third row, just hit this button once, and that gives us a nice wide access point. I've moved this seat all the way back and then reclined it to a comfortable position for that passenger. Sliding behind that seat at 6 feet tall, I've got knee room. The foot pockets are big enough to slide my feet under, and headroom is solid. Head clears the roof. That gets the thumbs up from me. Furthermore, I've got a suede-wrapped headliner and my own sunroof. Each rear passenger has their own air vent, seat recline functions, and a USB-A and C port. Cup holder, nicely padded armrest here. If I'm gonna complain about one thing, it's just that with this console here, this foot gets kind of jammed up. So if you had a middle passenger, they wouldn't have much in the way of legroom. Also, if we're just asking for things, maybe another climate control setting. Just, I mean, unnecessary would be nice. In the second row now, there's a leather-wrapped grab handle, so I can basically just walk on back here. Behind my own driving position, my knee room is kind of just okay, but this seat is slid almost all the way forward. The seat back is in leather. The foot pockets are big to slide my feet under. Thigh support is solid, and headroom is as well. Head clears the roof. Yet another thumbs up from me. There's an air vent on either side. I can, of course, slide the seat further back for much more knee room and recline it a ton so I can really lounge and enjoy my optional rear seat screen with a USB-C port and HDMI slot. So many different ways to charge your devices in this SUV, it's wild. You get another USB-A and C port on either side, an AC outlet and DC outlet. Slide this piece back for another USB-A and C port. This screen controls the second row climate and rear heating and ventilation. Lots of gloss black here that will smudge and scratch, especially with kids. Two cup holders are there, and inside we find a monstrous amount of storage space. Leather wrapped armrests are here, and your big glass roof. The second row has got it going on. Let's check out the front. Door close noise. Whoa, that was really loud. Not much dampening going on there. I mean, it sounds pretty solid. Smart keyless entry for the rear and front doors. These extravagant looking front seats are heated, ventilated, and massaging with two position memory. This Grand Wagoneer plaque illuminates at night, There's an aluminum tread plate. To open the tailgate, reach inside and press on that button there. And now we're getting to the good L stuff of the Grand Wagoneer long. Storage space. Also, by the way, with the air suspension lower to this access height, taller folks, you can hit your heads. 44 cubic feet of space we find behind the third row of seats. If you want more, press these two buttons to fold down the third row of seats. Now we've got 89 cubic feet of space. If that's not enough, press these two front buttons to send the second row tumbling down. Now we've got 131 cubic feet of space. All of those numbers are class leading and just insane. We've got rear tie down points. You've got a DC outlet, power raising third row of seats. The second row you got to do yourself. And then press and hold this button and get out of the way so the tailgate will close on up. Same materials on the front doors as the back. Plus you've got power adjusting and power folding door mirrors, and your seat settings are here. Yet another leather wrapped grab handle. We'll put the truck in accessory mode to turn on all of our screens. There's so many of them. There's a digital instrument cluster. You get a head-up display, this 12-inch touchscreen infotainment system that is user-friendly. The graphics are solid. Occasionally it has some lag. And then down here, right now it's a wireless smartphone charging pad and like six more USB ports. But if you press this, another screen comes down. This is for your climate control settings and your massaging seat adjustments. Also, there's a passenger display that we can't really see here. That's on purpose, so there's not driver distraction, but when you're on the passenger side, you can see it. Our final display is the digital rearview mirror. And I did forget to mention, there is wireless Apple CarPlay and Android Auto for the infotainment system. You get a physical volume knob and tuner, stitched leather up on the dashboard, and here around the console, where we find lots of that textured aluminum trim. Glad to see more of this than too much of the gloss black. Two cup holders are under there, and surprise, surprise, more USB device charging under here. Under the padded leather armrest, we find a cool box to keep your beverages extra cold. Visibility is excellent. Thank those large windows for that. And their standard blind spot monitoring with rear cross traffic. This cabin is dazzling. The material quality, the technology, the space, it's all top notch. Now let's take the Grand Wagoneer L for a drive. All right, let's fire it up. Nifty animation on the gauge cluster, lots of chimes, and the chimes in this vehicle are loud. Drive mode selection here. We'll begin in auto, then we can turn the aluminum gear selector to the right to take us into reverse. More chimes, more beeps. And that brings up a reasonably high resolution backup camera. This one has got lots of water drops on it because it's been raining all morning. We got our bird's eye view here off to the left. We can go to a wide angle backup view, wide angle front, narrower front view, and then a full screen backup camera. Let's do the wide angle. This is a wide load. Hoping the water drop isn't a vehicle. We'll do the turning radius test a bit later. For now, how about the world famous horn test? It's pretty soft. Soft and gentle for such a big, powerful SUV. Turn signal sound. I wonder if it's the pitch on that or something. I don't, as my daughter would say, I don't yike it. She's two, okay? Powertrain in the 23 Jeep Grand Wagoneer L. We got a new one. It's called the Hurricane. It's a 3-liter. Twin turbocharged six-cylinder that makes 510 horsepower and 500 pound-feet of torque. You can still get the 6.4-liter V8 in the regular Wagoneer that makes 471 horsepower, but this is the motor to have. Not only does it get you better fuel economy, and I mean, hear me out here,
14 mpg in the city, 19 on the highway, and 16 combined is better than 15 combined with the 6.4 liter V8. But you also get all of that extra power and torque. So getting this very large, very heavy SUV up to speed is effortless. Just a little bit of throttle input, and it just propels the SUV forward. That engine is mated to an 8-speed automatic gearbox and sends power to all four tires. And we do have a proper 2-speed transfer case for this four-wheel drive system. And with the air suspension that can raise up 3.6 inches, the Grand Wagoneer really can hack it off-road. We're not going to be doing that today, though. For now, we're just moseying. Those waves are big today. It's been storming. The Grand Wagoneer shares its platform with the Ram 1500, so it's a body-on-frame architecture. But unlike the Ram 1500, it doesn't have a solid rear axle. It has both independent suspensions for the front and rear. And that does facilitate better ride compliance. The chassis is still a little jittery at speed, but it feels way less firm than a solid axle truck. Let's try the turning radius test next. My, oh my. For a wheelbase length like that, that turn was properly tight. And from experience, maneuvering this vehicle in a parking lot, not nearly as difficult as one might expect. A tight turning radius is undervalued, I think, in this segment. Ride quality, beyond just the independent suspensions, from these adaptive dampers with air springs, is excellent. Yes, going over bumps, you do get jostled a bit, but the sharp impacts are muted, and those are what really wear on you and make you want to stop driving. You don't feel that here, and so you stay pretty much at ease. Now let's see how quick that Hurricane engine is to 60. For that, I've got my race box set up here. I'm then going to go into the sport drive mode and turn off the start-stop system. And this is a very slick surface. This is going to be a truly real world 0-60 test. I'll brake boost it a bit. And that is 60 in 5.5 seconds. For a slight uphill and for the slick roads that we're on, I'm very happy with that time. We didn't hear much from the Hurricane engine, and so you're not looking for that sonorous exhaust that you might get in the Cadillac Escalade or even in the 6.4 liter V8 version of the Wagoneer. But instead, you get excellent acceleration. Not much in the way of hesitation at all from that twin turbo setup. It just buckles down and gets moving. Let's prod that mid-range power a little more. So I'm first just going to put my foot down to see how quickly it downshifts. Which is quick enough, for sure. There's also a manual mode here, these tiny little tabs. And the downshifts are not quick. But it will let you go all the way to redline. And when you're above 3,500 to 4,000 RPM, the boost has built. And you really do tear forward. I'm quite impressed with this engine. The manual mode really, I mean, is just for towing. Let's just ignore that. Focus more on the fact that the engine will kick down a couple gears as needed and get you in to the part of the power band that really lets this engine come alive. Passing power, Grand Wagoneer L has plenty of it. In the same way I didn't expect performance car shift speed out of this gearbox, I'm not going to expect performance car handling and braking, but let's see if the Grand Wagoneer L can at least control its own body in what we'll simulate as an emergency maneuver. So here we go, carrying some speed here. Hard on those brakes. Ooh, didn't like the brake feel. Now carrying some speed into the curve, the nose plows heavily. Steering is vague. And the body leans considerably. Was not thrilled with those dynamics there. On wet roads and on all season tires, I don't expect the braking to be incredible. But the tuning of the pedal is not good. I did not get that initial bite. The pedal kind of mushed on me halfway through as well. Then after the turn-in, the nose just wanted to keep going. And the steering gave zero feedback whatsoever. And I'm comparing this in my mind to the Cadillac Escalade that I drove not too long ago. And yes, it was on dry roads when I did it. And so I'm trying to, in my mind, sort that out. But it did feel more in control of itself. I'd feel more confident in an emergency situation at the helm of the Escalade. Now that we're on the highway, I'm going to turn on the lane keep assist feature and activate the adaptive cruise control function. And it is an active lane management, so if I start to deviate, it does give a gentle correction back to the center of the lane. This is a very loud road surface we're on right now. And it's a good test of the cabin insulation. Because though I heard some tire noise, and maybe I'm just taking a lot of issue with these tires, the cabin stayed pretty hushed. The wind noise is kept to a minimum, just here at the seams. And the road noise is muted. You could easily have a conversation with your passengers without having to raise your voice too much, except for the third row. That one you're shouting. The Grand Wagoneer L suits itself well to long road trips for sure. And I feel like I can assign a miles per hour word of the day to the Grand Wagoneer L. And that word is veiled, meaning not openly expressed. And I'm talking about what you find with the Grand Wagoneer L beyond the bodywork. Because for me, the styling, particularly the profile, is not aesthetically pleasing. And yet, beyond that, or under the veil, we've got a sumptuous interior, technological sophistication, excellent ride quality, a potent motor, and tons of space for passengers and cargo. So it's worth getting beyond the veil to find the gem that is the Grand Wagoneer L. Now let's talk pricing and competition. The starting figure for the Grand Wagoneer L is $93,500. This one is tested. The Obsidian trim is just under $109,000. And I do, for reference, think this is the best trim for this vehicle. Competing against the Grand Wagoneer L, we've got the Cadillac Escalade ESV four-wheel drive. That one starts just under $89,000, though a similarly equipped model would be about $110,000. It makes 420 horsepower from its V8 motor, It gets to 60 in 6.1 seconds and has a fuel economy rating of 16 combined. Then we've got the Lincoln Navigator L four-wheel drive. That one starts at $97,000. It makes 440 horsepower from its twin-turbo V6. It gets to 60 in 5.4 seconds, and the fuel economy is the best in segment, 18 combined. In addition to the fuel economy, the Lincoln Navigator seats, I've got to say, are the best I've felt in an SUV. 30-way power adjustments, you can get comfortable, believe me. The Cadillac Escalade, meanwhile, it has this curb appeal that neither this nor the Navigator have. It just exudes American luxury and status. It also is better to drive in terms of confidence behind the wheel. The handling and braking performance I felt were better than this vehicle. I'm between this one and the Escalade because the Grand Wagoneer has the most cargo space. It has the nicest interior with the best attention to detail, and it has the greatest potency from its motor. But it is a little hard to get beyond the looks. I would say if you don't mind the looks of this vehicle, don't question it. Just get the Grand Wagoneer L. But if they bother you, don't feel like the Escalade isn't going to come close in terms of the technology, luxury, and space. I'm thinking I'm going with the Escalade, but it's not a big win, and I expected that coming in. I thought the Escalade was just going to have this huge gap over this vehicle, and it just doesn't. This is a really well put together SUV. What do you guys think? Which would you have? This, the Navigator, or the Escalade? Let me know in the comments. I hope you guys have enjoyed this POV drive review. If you did, please like, comment, and share the video. Subscribe to the channel. Hit that bell to get notified, and I'll see you next time.